Good morning. Welcome you all to church this morning. We are glad that you are here. If you are visiting with us, we are also very glad that you are here. And everyone is invited after church to join us at the lemonade table for refreshment. This morning, the outreach committee has provided goodies for us. The gentle yoga class, which meets on Tuesday, has been on hiatus for July, and they will resume on August the 1st. And that is the announcements I have for you today, so let us worship God.
Declare the glory of the Lord.
The stars and the sun shall not pass without grace.
Without words or sounds, they proclaim God's glory. God is amazing. God made the stars and the sun from nothing. Let us worship God.
God's people, let us together go to God in prayer. All wise God, you know how much we enjoy being honored above others and how much we resent the special requests others receive. You are aware of our shortcuts for our own advantage. You see the ways we pretend to be more than we are. You observe not only our actions, but our motives as well. We need your help to put away all that is false and to discover our true identity as your children. Lift us up in your forgiving love, we pray. Amen. God has not left us to suffer because of our sin. God has come to rescue us by the sacrifice of God's Son. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
I love when you preach on Sunday.
And guides our way. As we hear it today, may we use it to be your people doing your work. Amen. The scripture reading is Psalm 8. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouths of babes and infants, you have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen and the beasts of the fields, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea. Whatever passes along the paths of the seas, O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Thank you.
Gracious God, as we bring forth our gifts, may we know that they are used to love and serve and to help in this world, giving you the glory for all that you do and all that we can accomplish. In your name we pray. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we come here today with thankful hearts, for you give us so many wonderful gifts. This planet to enjoy all things, our families and loved ones who love us, support us, and challenge us to be better people. We are given your love, O God, so that we too can do all things. We are thankful for so much, and today we are most grateful for our ability to pray. We thank you that we believe and trust in you with the whole of our lives in prayer. We believe that our joys and concerns, our hopes, our fears, and our frustrations are all in your precious hands. We know that you not only hear our prayers, but that you also act on our prayers to soothe our worries, help with our troubles, and provide us with courage and confidence beyond our expectations. We are grateful, O God, that when we pray, we are tapping directly into your great love for us, a love that is special, a love that we can share with others, a love that helps us to serve, to do your will, a love that catches us every time we fall. Lord, we are grateful that when we pray, we can strengthen our faith. We do not always understand what things mean and why things happen, but being connected to you in prayer teaches us that our faith can see us through. Our faith can help us see the power and mysteries of you, O God. Our faith can help us to move forward. And our faith, even one as small as a mustard seed, can do amazing and wonderful things in your name. Help us, O God, to appreciate our gift of prayer, to use that gift every day, and help us to always have the desire to pray for one another. Today, we lift up to you Barbara, Donna, Doris, Dave, and Erica. God, hear our hearts as we pray for all in this world, those who lead, those who struggle, those who know you, and those who have never met you. May your love be with each one. We know, O God, that from our hearts you hear and bless the prayers of your people. We ask that you hear us now as we pray, as you taught us to do so, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our sermon text this morning comes from Luke chapter 11, verses 37 to 44. While he was speaking, a Pharisee invited him to dine with him. So he went in and took his place at the table. The Pharisee was amazed to see that he did not first wash before dinner. Then the Lord said to him, "Now you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. You fools! Did not the one who made the outside make the inside also? So give for alms those things that are within, and see everything will be clean for you. But woe to the Pharisees, for you tithe mint and rue and herbs of all kinds, and neglect justice and the love of God. It is these you ought to have practiced, without neglecting the others. Woe to you, Pharisees, for you love to have the seat of honor in the synagogues and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. Woe to you, for you are like unmarked graves, and people walk over them without realizing it." This is the word of God.
And let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, be with us this day. Open our hearts and minds to your word. And let us live your word now and always. Amen. In today's Bible reading, Jesus was invited to dinner by a Pharisee. Now we know that Jesus was at odds with this group of leaders. So one would think that an invitation to a meal would be a good sign. Maybe this man was offering Jesus an olive branch. Maybe a truce was on the way. How about a fresh start? Or trying to understand what Jesus was doing by getting to know him in a more relaxed and casual setting. Well, none of that is true because we don't even get to the meal portion of the evening before we find that Jesus is at odds with this Pharisee. The issue that upsets his host is that Jesus did not wash his hands before he ate dinner. Now, personally, I'm convinced that this Pharisee must have known my parents. When I was growing up, washing hands before dinner seemed to be a necessary and vitally important event for my mom and dad. In my home, the following scene would occur over and over and over again. We three boys would be told to wash our hands before coming to the dinner table. And we would scurry away and we would wash. We would return. My dad would say, "Did you wash your hands?" We would reply, "Yes." He would say, "Show me." We would present arms. He would say, "Wash them again." We would scamper away. Upon our return, we would again present arms. He would say, "Wash them again. And this time, lean on the soap." And on it would go. Like my parents, the Pharisee seemed to take a keen interest in the fact that Jesus came to dinner with dirty hands. The faux pas on the part of Jesus had nothing to do with the state of his hands and had everything to do with the ceremonial law. Now, here is how my commentary lays out that law. The law laid it down that before a person ate, the hands were to be washed in a certain way, and that they must be washed between each course. As usual, every littlest detail was worked out. Large stone vessels of water were specially kept for the purpose because ordinary water might be unclean. The amount of water used must be at least a quarter of a log, or enough to fill 1.5 eggshells. First, the water was to be poured over the hands, beginning at the tips of the fingers and running down to the wrist. Then the palm of each hand must be cleansed by rubbing the fist of it into the other. Finally, the water was again poured over the hand, this time beginning at the wrist and running down to the fingertips. To the Pharisee, to omit the slightest detail was to commit a sin. Jesus was not responding to the fact that he didn't wash. He was informing the Pharisee that as a group of leaders, they were focusing on the wrong things, which meant they had the totally wrong idea about God. So today I want to concentrate on the issues that Jesus condemned the Pharisees for breaching. First, they were more concerned with how others saw them than they were with doing God's work. The word Pharisee means the separated ones, and that is how these elite of God saw themselves, set apart and on a different level than the common individual. Because of this, most of what they did was done for effect. It was so others could say, look how good and kind, how decent and righteous, how obedient and proper the Pharisees are. Surely they are well favored in the eyes of our God. Jesus confronted their actions by calling out this pious behavior. He mentions their almsgiving and their ceremonial law practices and tithing. It all looked impressive, but it was for show. Jesus said that they loved to be given seats of honor and to be recognized in public arenas. But again, this behavior was not to celebrate God. It came from a place of selfishness, not compassion, a place of personal gain, not sincere interests, a place of self-importance, not genuine concern. The Pharisees spent so much time being separated and removed and set apart and holier than thou and better than anyone else that they forgot how to care for even one solitary person. They needed to spend more time on their hearts and less time worrying about how they were being perceived. And unfortunately, we sometimes fall into the same trap. We as people are constantly thinking about outside perceptions. Do we not spend too much time on wondering what others will think, pondering what we can do so others will like us? We question whether we have done a good job and if we are being perceived in a positive light. Do we not worry whether people will think we are knowledgeable and insightful and capable and competent? Aren't we too busy keeping up appearances, keeping up with the Joneses, keeping up the walls that protect us? Have you ever wanted to send someone a thinking of you card, but you didn't? You changed your mind because you were afraid that they might not like it or it was intrusive. Has your instinct ever told you to apologize for your behavior, but you didn't because that would be to admit you were in the wrong? Have you gotten upset for not getting the credit you deserve? How many times has your heart not been in the right place? Too often, how we see ourselves and what people think of us is what we let rule the day. What would happen if we worked as much on our hearts as we did on how we were perceived? The actions of our hearts, those things that come from the inside, are just as important as how we are thought of on the outside. We need to allow our hearts to guide our behavior by listening more, by thinking more about others than we do about ourselves, by worrying less, by doing more, by acting on love, by leaving the ego at the door, by putting Christ first and others second and our needs a distant third. At the end of the day, should we really be caring about what someone else thinks? Remember, the goal is to focus as much on the inside as the attention we give to the outside. Paying a bit more attention to what's inside is a wonderful way to cleanse our hearts and to bring us closer to our loving Creator. The second mistake committed by the Pharisees was that they were concerned about the external things in life. To the casual observer, I'm sure that they seemed to be wonderful, God-fearing, dedicated servants. They were certainly an elite class of individuals. There were only ever 600 of them at one time. They spent years studying every iota of the law. They knew God's word backwards and forwards. They kept all the rites and the rules and the regulations so that the law could be observed and obeyed at all times. They were without a doubt expert when it came to religion. The problem was they were not sincere, which meant they were not practicing what they were preaching. That also is an important bit of our faith journey. Our eyes can see that God needs work to be done. Our ears can hear the suffering of others. Our lips can say the right things. Our words can give comfort at the proper moment. Our mind can process and understand all that is in Scripture. Our feet can bring us to worship every Sunday. And our hands can write and give checks generously. However, if we don't feel God in our hearts, if we can't live out our faith with Christ, if God's Spirit is not in our souls, we are missing the reality of what Christianity means. For us to have that thriving personal relationship with the living Christ, we must do more than what our eyes can see, our ears can hear, our words can express, our minds can process, and what our feet and hands can provide. In other words, why are we living for God? Is it so we can have an impressive list of accomplishments? Is it to make God happy and proud of us? Is it to make others like us or see how good we are? Is it because that's the way we were raised? Is it because it makes us feel good? It satisfies our desire to be good? Or maybe we do good works because we have nothing better to do. We all know that living our lives for God is in grateful response to all that God does for us. It is not done out of necessity, it is done out of love. Our relationship with God needs to be embraced and lived out and enveloped and be as important as the air we breathe, because God is as important as the air we breathe. The third mistake that the Pharisees made was that they were too focused on the details. Strip your faith down to one thing. What is it? Is it prayer? Studying Scripture? Putting God first? Coming to church? Is it giving to charity? Helping this church with your tithes and gifts and treasures? Is it worship? Sunday morning, helping others, showing others God's love? Is it grace, mercy, forgiveness, eternal life? If your relationship with God was reduced to only one thing, which of these would you choose? I think we Christians, like those Pharisees of long ago, sometimes get lost in the details. We think we have God all figured out. We think we know better. We are sure we have God's laws down pat. We still debate and argue over what is and what is not sinful behavior. Who is and who is not welcome in God's house of worship? How should we be spending our endowments, our investments? Who gets to serve on what committee? And the ever popular, we have never done it that way before. Followed closely by, we have always done it that way before. Too many details. If you could pare your faith down to one thing, what would it be? There is a legend that states that in 1962, a famous theologian was asked this very question. Karl Barth was at a chapel on the University of Chicago during his lecture tour, and at the Q&A time, a student asked him if he could summarize his whole life's work of theology into one sentence. And the legend says that Barr said, "Yes, I can. In the words of a song I learned at my mother's knee, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." That should be the starting point, the crux, and the end all of our faith. Not the dogma, the rules, the committees, the politics. Can it really be that simple? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Yes, It can be as simple or as complicated as we make it. So leave this place and serve in Christ's name. Venture into the world and do something for God. Show others that it's what is in the inside that counts. Live for God first, and then let everything else fall into place. And live honestly and shamelessly and compassionately for no other reason than Jesus loves you. There is a legend that I just made up that states that when Jesus was starting his ministry, that he reached out for help. So I have in my hands a letter that he one day received in order to help him in his venture of doing God's work. The letter says, "To Jesus, son of Joseph, Woodcrafters Carpenter Shop, Nazareth 25922. From the Jerusalem Management Consulting Firm. Dear Sir, thank you for submitting the resumes of the 12 men you have picked for managerial positions in your new organization. All of them have now taken our battery of tests. These tests have been run through our computer programs for analysis. Also, everyone has met one-on-one with our psychologist and our vocational aptitude consultant. We suggest that you study the profiles and test results, as our insights might prove useful in your decision of whether or not to hire these gentlemen. As part of our service, we have made some general comments for your guidance. It is the company's professional assessment that most of the individuals you have selected are not suitable for the positions you wish to fill. Generally speaking, these nominees are lacking in background, experience, education, and vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise you are undertaking. They also do not display any traits that would suggest they could work in a collaborative and team atmosphere. Currently, we recommend that you continue your search for persons of experience in managerial ability and proven capability. Our tests reveal the following specific deficiencies. Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of temper. He tends to speak first and think later. He's a bit brash to be a manager. His brother Andrew has absolutely no qualities of leadership. He tends to lean on others when making decisions, and some of the people he asks to help are unsuitable. In one instance, we discovered he would not mind asking children to help with really big problems. Then there are the sons of Zebedee, James and John. They are too ambitious. They will want to be near the CEO at all times, even wanting to sit one on his left and one on his right. We feel that they would place personal interest above company loyalty. Thomas demonstrates a questioning attitude that would tend to undermine morale. Now, don't get us wrong, asking questions is important to being a good manager, but with Thomas, wait for it, we doubt his sincerity. We feel that it is our duty to tell you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. Although not proven, it is thought that he was keeping some of those profits for himself. We feel that Philip has a chance, but he keeps being distracted from his work to go and help others, and he's just too much of a decent fellow to be in management. James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, both registered a high score on the manic depressive scale. And Simon has a lot of radical leanings. You should certainly keep your eye on him. And of course, one of the candidates showed great potential. A man of ability and resourcefulness. One who meets people well, has a keen business mind, and has contacts in high places. He is highly motivated, ambitious, and responsible, and we definitely, without reservation, recommend Judas Iscariot as your controller and your right-hand man. We wish you every success in your new venture. Sincerely, the Jordan Management Consulting Firm. What do you think would happen? What would life be like today if these recommendations were followed? If Judas was Jesus' right-hand man, if he had chosen another 11 disciples instead of the ones that were selected? I wonder how this firm could have gotten it all wrong. They were knowledgeable, they were intelligent, they were professional, they had all the tools, they were the ones to seek out, yet they didn't do it right. It's because their battery of tests and all their assessments only dealt with the external. They didn't see into the heart, they didn't see these men for how they lived and could be ruled by their hearts. Fortunately, Jesus got it right and we don't have that issue. For the greatest gift we have is that Jesus sees into our hearts. And when we live from the inside out, we live and all is well. Let us pray. Gracious God, send us out to be and live and do your things. Let us live with our hearts first, serving all in your name. Amen.
Please stand if you are able and join in affirming our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Sent. Wherever you go this week, consider that God is sending you there. Wherever you find yourself this week, consider that God is placing you there. That the love of Christ that dwells within you can reach out and touch others through you. Know this, go in God's love, God's peace, and God's power. Amen.